Hey, what's going on, everybody? So let's go down south to the ATL and check in with my man Chalk from Soul For Real to find out what clips he has this week for us on this segment of Dumbass People For Real. What's going on, Chalk?
What up, Todd? It's a beautiful day out here in Atlanta, as you can see. I'm loving it. But here's my pick of the week for Dumbass People For Real. Watch.
Yo, guys, stay tuned, because I'll be right back with Flipmo Squad's Rah Digga. So welcome back. So my guest tonight is a hip-hop MC of the legendary Flipmo Squad. She's an actress, community activist, and an all-around incredible person, and I'm looking forward to interviewing her tonight. But before we do, let's take a look at a clip.
Shake, take this through the roof. See me on the move. Checking cats like who's who. Fall through a little spot. Me and the whole gang. Flirt with a couple cats, but I don't say no names. Here we go now. I'm like gypsy chick. See me cruising on tilt at my 60s whip. And we off to the races. Me and all my aces. Everywhere we go, the same faces. Wave your hands. Jersey clan. Trick a little something at MGM Grand. Mommy fly. Watch a man. Me taking losses. I be damned. What's the crew name?
Welcome to the show, Rah Digga.
I am well. Shouts out to everybody tuning in. If you're just now tuning in, I never go live, so, you know, consider yourself lucky. Very few folks that I go live with, so, you know, I really do.
I you know what it is? It's the humbleness I have with everybody I meet. I'm really gave this industry a brand new type of show, and it seems everybody loves. And I was just talking. I just landed Anthrax, Jane's Addiction, Fishbone, and one of the biggest composers in Hollywood of 25 films in future dates, because everybody just loves the fact, like, hey, there's an interview where people have a good time, and that's the point. It's about, you know, having fun.
Well, good, you know what I'm saying? Man.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. And I appreciate you for saying what you said. It means a lot to me. It really does. I have a lot of respect for you. I always have. I want to talk about the first thing that's important to me, because I love when celebrities do this. You're a big-time community activist, if people don't know by now, especially in the community of Newark, New Jersey, where you go back to a lot of schools. So tell me why you decided to really, really get back, because everybody has their own opinion on why they do what they do.
Well, for me, I always, you know, it started, I didn't really look at it as activism at the time. I mean, I've always been a big stickler for education, and it was important to me, even throughout my music career, through all of my, like, I'll fuck you up on the mic. It was always important to, like, emphasize education, right. You know, whenever I got the chance to do so. So that was something that was very important to me. I was fortunate enough to receive a full scholarship to attend a very prestigious boarding school out of state in Maryland, and that was high school year. So it just kind of dawned on me then, like, wow, you know. And then once I came back home and just really, you know, got back in touch with the community and stuff, it dawned on me, like, there are a lot of people that really live life not leaving, like, the 5 square mile radius of their neighborhood. So I wanted to, you know, I always wanted to do my part to give people that opportunity, you know, to experience life outside of their confines. And I started something I started doing with my daughter and all of my nieces and nephews. Like, we used to just get up and make sandwiches and take them down to the homeless people in Penn Station, or whenever, you know, whenever friends of mine would have these swanky dinner parties and they're just throwing away hundreds of dollars of food. I'm saying, don't throw that in the garbage. Like, let me pack it up and I'll drop it off to a homeless shelter, or I'll just, you know, I just never wanted to, you know, I never wanted to see people waste food like that and just be wasteful. I was always cognizant of people that are less fortunate. So I always, you know, any chance I could, and I didn't do it, you know, before social media. It wasn't anything to brag on social media about, because there wasn't any social media. I was doing it because I, you know, I just felt morally obligated to do that. So something small turned into something big. I created the Feed Me Foundation, and we just started at that point. We just started, you know, just gathering things, and I would, you know, I would get like before the online consignment shops, I would have my celebrity friends, you know, donate stuff that they, you know, wear one time, you get photographed in it, you don't want to wear it again. I would just have them donate those things to me. I would take them to women's shelters, and it would just make these women feel good. Women that were hard on their luck, and you know, now you can actually wear something that you just saw, you know, Taraji on the red carpet with, or just something to boost morale, really, you know, if not for anything else. And then I founded the Lyrics Matter Foundation,
and I was gonna ask you that.
Mm-hmm. And that was something that I felt morally obligated to do, because I said, you know what, it started as a program to take kids off the street. Like, hey, y'all just kind of lingering around, you know. I chopped it up with the mayor, and we were finding like a lot of the kids, especially maybe they were high school, maybe they dropped out of high school, or maybe they graduated high school and, you know, didn't make it to their college of choice, and now they're just kind of lingering in the neighborhood. And we know idle minds are the devil's playground. So what I decided to do was, hey, I'm going to create this program. Come, you know, come learn about hip hop. Come, you know, here's a place where you can listen to other musicians come and speak. Maybe, you know, it may spark something in you. So then what happened, that program went so well, and I was getting funding from the city to do it. So now you have the good kids in school. You have kids that were actually paying attention and trying to major in music. Like, well, wait, why is this just for the bad kids? Like, I'm actually doing well in school to do this. This is actually a goal of mine. So then I expanded it to high schools in general. And then the college students said, well, why is this just limited to high school? So then I started doing guest lectures at different colleges. And then you had the neighboring cities like, well, why is this just a North thing? We East Orange, we want it. Irvington, we want it. Jersey City, we want it. So then I started expanding to the neighboring cities. And then the suburbs said, well, hey, is this just an urban city thing? Can we get this program out in the burbs? Hey, we've got some cool white kids that want to learn about the hospital. So then it expanded, you know, to those cities. Next thing you know, I'm getting requests from out of state like, well, is this just a Jersey thing? Can we get this in New York? Can we get this in Delaware? Can we get this in Philly? And you know, and before you knew it, it was hey, why is this only in America? Can you do some online stuff for us overseas? So it's been, you know, it's been a huge success. I was actually doing them in person up until the pandemic. And once that hit, I had to just kind of change my motto a little bit and do it online. But I do master classes, and all of this information can be found on my website, but it kept me busy, and I found myself feeling like, well, you know, if I'm not going to get out here and kick rappers' asses on a consistent basis, I might as well teach it. So we did a lot of fun things. I took them on, tours of the Bronx to see all the stopping. Hey, check, here's 1520 Sedgwick Avenue. We've gone up to radio stations. We went up to Sirius. I take them to record labels, and a lot of times you'll get people that thought they wanted to rap, but then after they go through this journey with me, they say, well, maybe rap isn't cut out for me. Maybe I'll be an engineer, or, you know, I'm pretty good with numbers. Maybe I can be someone's business manager, or, you know, they kind of find themselves, I get to bring out of them what they didn't realize they had. Because you have some people who have zero, who sign up for my workshops. They have zero interest in music. And then when it's all said and done, like, they're like, no, I want to make music. Or vice versa. You'll have someone who just thinks they're going to be the next Drake. And then they'll take one of my workshops. Because I also, you know, I give them the hip-hop history and the rap techniques. They'll take my workshop and say, well, maybe music isn't for me, but I'll be a great manager. So it's, they get a little bit of everything, and hopefully they can apply it to whatever field that they decide to pursue, whether it's, you know, even if it's outside of entertainment. I just think somebody that's been, you know, doing this as long as I have on every level, from being a major, you know, to being an indie, in the group, to two groups, solos, I've toured nationally, I've toured internationally, by myself, crew, like, I can give you every single aspect and every component of what it is to be an artist in this music industry, so.
Yeah, and it's tough, it's really tough. By the way, I have a lot more respect for you for what you pretty much just said. I'm a big person on giving back, and we'll get to know each other more, but I actually run New York City's Peace Concert at Times Square every year. That big concert that happens in the fall, I'm the guy that created that. And we're supposed to be doing it this year because COVID's up, right? Mm. And they asked me last minute, could you do it in September again? I said I would love to, but see, when they ask people to do big shows, they forget one thing. Guys, you know, to get sponsors takes about a year to do. You know, that to come in. So we're working on that, but I've been blessed to work with so many great organizations, from Salvation Army and New York Cares to AIDS to Cancer Foundation to Leukemia, and hearing people like you doing what you do to give back is such a selfless act that I wish more and more people honestly would do, because it's needed. And it's not for just homeless people or anything. There are people out there are very successful that find themselves in a hole, because that's part of life. You know, and people get that confused. They're thinking homeless people, oh, they're dirty, oh, they're this, blah, blah, blah. Listen, I have friends that are 6-7-figure people now that were homeless at one time, because you don't know what happened in their lives that caused them to get there.
Exactly.
You know, and I tell people, don't judge anybody. Yes, there are homeless people that have something wrong up here, but that was something
you have those cases of mentally ill where there's obvious mental illness going on, and the healthcare system just simply fails them. But then you'll have someone who's got everything going for them, and something as simple as losing their job, or, you know, losing a spouse,
messes somebody up.
You know, it's things like that that will just start a domino effect of unfortunate events happening for people, and before you know it, you can be a homeowner with a family, with a, you know, a two income household, to living in a homeless shelter with your kids, just like that. So it affects more people than we know. And a lot of people, you know, they put on this face, they put on a brave front. And now, especially in the day and age we are of social media, like, everybody's fronting on social media, and that pressure can really crack people. So that's, you know, that's why I enjoy doing what I do. And, you know, like I said, when I, you know, especially I see it a lot with the women in the women's shelter that I visit. Like, a lot of these women, you know, they have it going on, and sometimes they may find themselves in an abusive relationship, and they literally have to just leave their situation with nothing but the clothes on their back and start from scratch. So it's not that they're lazy or, you know, they don't have their shit together. It's just life throws curveballs at you that you may or may not be prepared to deal with. And imagine being a woman in that situation, just literally having to pick up and go because your life and your children's life depends on it. And then you have Rah Digga just, hey, Chanel bags for everyone. So it's like, as superficial as it may sound, like, you would be surprised, like, these little tokens, like, what they will do for the morale of some of these people. And you know, it makes me happy to make them happy.
And I love that. And one question I'm going to ask you, I ask a lot of the hip-hop artists right now because I was a part of it. What was your feeling when you heard that the hip-hop museum had finally made its groundbreaking after 10 years of trying to put that together in the Bronx? Did you hear about that? Because a lot of people weren't there because it was kind of hard to get everybody there because it's during COVID. Mm-hmm. What was your feeling about it when you heard that finally 10 years Rocky Cubano's been trying to get the money for it? And Rocky's such a great guy. And
yes, he is.
I feel so short around him. I'm 6'2". He like 8 feet tall.
Right.
And, when they did the groundbreaking, not a lot of people could be there. And I'm letting people know it wasn't that they didn't want to invite you. They had to go by New York City rules at that time. Mm-hmm. So they were trying to bring in the press and the people that donated money and stuff like that. How did you feel when you heard that finally Microsoft came in, wham, $5 million, New York City is going to be the home of pretty much the Rock and Roll Museum Hall of Fame for the Hip Hop Museum? How did you feel about that when you heard about it?
Well, when he first, you know, I've known Rocky for a very long time, and in fact, you know, we communicated a lot in the beginning stages. So when he first shared his plans with me and told me what he was going to do, like, I thought it was a dope idea. I thought it was long overdue. I thought that if the community were to rally behind it properly, like, this could be something really big. This could be our Smithsonian. And I know it sometimes you have to do it to make, you know, to make it make sense to people. I think in the beginning, I think a lot of people, there were probably a bunch of naysayers. They were probably,
because everybody said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do a Hall of Fame. I'm going to do this. But they don't understand. I understand it because I do it. They don't understand the money that it takes to do
right.
that. They don't understand there's a permit process.
Right.
You also got to speak with the unions. Because whenever you build anything anywhere, the first thing you got to do is find out who's the union for this area, right?
Yep.
And then you got to deal with politics. Now, when people are like, oh, politics, guys, whether you like it or not, politicians are really the ones in the big office that really can push you forward.
Right.
And make it happen.
No, the politics aspect of it, I think, is the most serious because, you know, don't forget, you know, there are a million other entities that are probably bidding for that same space. You know, you probably got some big wig developers like a hip-hop museum. I could put a mall there. I could put some overpriced high-rises there. You know, I could really generate money for the city. What's a hip-hop museum, you know, gonna do? So not only did Rocky have to contest with that, you know,
yeah.
I'm sure he had to contest with naysayers within the hip hop community. You know, there are probably people that were jealous that they didn't come up with the idea first, and just, you know, kind of, I'm not going to say wish the downfall of it, but almost like, good luck with that, or you know that.
Oh yeah,
you know that nasty, ugly little green monster called envy, and I'm pretty sure there are people that probably felt like, oh, you know, who's this guy think he is? He's gonna build a hip hop museum, huh? I created hip hop, and I'm not putting words in any.
No, I get it. No, but you're hitting everything on the money.
I'm pretty sure he was met with resistance probably on every level, but I think it's so dope, and good things come to those who wait. Hey, Rome wasn't built in a day. The Colosseum wasn't built in a day. So however long it took, it's finally happening. And I was actually present for the groundbreaking. I wasn't able to get to the actual part with the shovels in the ground, because
I covered it. Yeah, I was at the groundbreaking. I covered the entire thing.
One thing
It's funny that I didn't was able to get to you, because there were people there. I don't know how they were there. There were people that were really rude. When guys like LL and Fat Joe, you, a couple of others, where the media, because I was with CBS, NBC, and ABC. They're all my friends. We were in the back filming. And when we wanted to go interview you guys, just to get a word, we had so many people literally step in front of an ABC camera and go, can I get a selfie? And then more people came in, and it got to the point where none of you guys actually were able to get interviews with any of the major stations because of that, because it became a cluster. So I apologize as I wasn't able to get to you, but I'm glad.
No, it's fine. I actually didn't get on the ground with the shovels, because I learned do not wear high heels to a groundbreaking. So yeah, I wasn't coming. I was just looking fine from the sideline, but then I did ultimately make it to the reception afterwards. So that was the indoor space, and that was more calm, cool, and collected, and he gave out awards, and I got to, I got to meet and greet some old friends, some legends, a lot of just a lot of cool people, a lot of the people that made it possible for us to even have a genre of music called hip hop. So I was just happy to be there. I was upset that I wasn't able to get in that picture with Fat Joe and LL.
Nah, right?
Everybody, but I was just happy to even be in the space, because that's something that's going to be monumental. That's going to be part of the ancient scrolls 100 years from now, when our great 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 grandchildren are teaching their children about hip hop. You know, they can go back to these old archaic pictures from 2021 when this building was first being created, and I would be I would just be happy to even be in the conversation, really.
Oh, you'll be in the conversation, because right now, I feel, me personally, there's a lot of great female MCs and starting to be in the game. Not a lot, though. There definitely needs to be a lot more. You're an amazing MC. And there's so many others. I love music. And by the way, at the Revolution, I was sitting with DJ Wiz, and I think we had too many of those little wines. That's probably why I didn't see you out there at that part, because I was just a little out there. But definitely a great MC. I mean, you've been through a lot. And I do want to ask some, I don't know if anybody asked you yet, I'm really happy to see that Summer Jam's coming back. And I think they're trying to take it to another level, because New York City right now is making monster events for 2021. They really want to come back strong. And even though it's in the Meadowlands, it's still New York City the way I look at it, right?
It's going to be interesting, these big arenas, because Now, is it official, like, you can't come in those spaces now unless you're vaccinated?
As far as I know, because I have to keep up with it, I got vaccinated. I think there are going to be definite rules where if you're not vaccinated, I don't think they're going to let you in, because with a crowd of that big, you can't afford to. Because if somebody gets sick and dies at your crowd, and let's say they weren't vaccinated and you didn't check them, Hot 97 is going to be liable for it. So I really don't foresee that. I'm just speculating.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely don't see any performer being able to come in unless they're vaccinated. Mm-hmm. Because you know how performers bring their entourage?
Mm-hmm.
You know, French Montana, hey, we need you to bring three people. He'll show up with a freaking bus of like 80 people. And it's like, dude, this is not a party. It's a concert. So I would love to see kind of like an all-female type of thing where you all just come out to take down the mic and just tear up the crowd. Like all the dope MCs from different eras. I think that would be incredible.
There was a show that I did, I want to say 2018. And I thought it showed great promise to be, you know, to manifest into a tour situation. But it didn't happen. However, when I tell you, just about every female you could think of was on this bill, from Nikki D to Moni Love to Mia X to Lady of Rage to MC Light to Trina to Eve to Remy, myself. There was just so many, like there were so many of us, and you know, it was great. And we actually collected deposits for the second show, but then Corona happened, and I just haven't heard anything about it since. But I'm wondering if that's something that's still going to happen, because I know they were going to switch the lineup a little bit, you know, as they moved around. Because once everybody saw how much of a success, I think there were naysayers in the beginning, like, oh my God, you're going to get a bunch of females together on one lineup. Like, as much as people say that, because you hear that all the time, like, it would be dope, all-female tour, all-female this, all-female that. Sure. Sounds good in theory. I think it's way more of a headache, like, even more so than the guys. First of all, you're getting a bunch of women together. We all got our periods. It's like, hey, man.
Come on, it could be like a new VH1 drama show.
Hold on.
It could be like a new reality TV.
My screen just went dark. Let me make sure I'm not losing you.
And all these women on the same stage, it'll be a new reality show. Call it like Love and Bitch Slap. Like, don't go on the stage before me. I'll cut you right there. Don't be coming on here and then be like, oh my God. Cardi B comes in with the butt, just throwing everybody around. Little Kim just starts slapping people around. Next right. On VH1, like, Ladies of Bitch Slap. Check it out. It's like, okay.
Oh, okay. I see what's happening. Hang on. I might have to. One second. I'm gonna have to plug up in here. Hang on, let me get situated with a charger. Be back in 60 seconds. I'm back. Oh yeah, I sent you the request. I'm like, I don't think he knows I'm here.
I got you. And guys, that commercial break was brought to you by Purell. It's great for your hair and smooth on your face. Purell. Get it. You know? So welcome back. Welcome back. So I'm glad to hear that all-female concert that you're talking about. I think that'd be really cool. You know what it is? Before COVID, I think it was easier to put on a show like that, right? Now the producers have to look at it from a money stand. Even though they always looked at a money stand point of view, you have to look at it different now, right?
Right.
You're a known person. A lot of the other people are known person. You know how they're really looking at it. And it's not an insult to you. It's just their business, because I know how they run. They're trying to see, can we get a girl like a Megan Thee Stallion on this bill? Because in order for us to make the money that we lost over the year, if we can get her with the Rah Digga and everybody else, we should be able to sell out. We don't have to worry about people saying like an all-women lineup, blah, blah, blah. And that's the way producers look at it. They want to bring the top of the talent. That's why you're on there, right? That's why MC Light is on there. But they're also going to look to probably bring some of the heavy hitters that are, that just win Grammys.
Absolutely.
Because who's spending the money, right? Me and you are near the same age. I mean, let's cut the bull. Me and you don't really go to shows anymore and spend $150 to go buy a ticket, right? We don't do that. No, but the millennials do that. We don't.
Shit, so, if I ain't on the list, I ain't coming in.
Exactly. And if I'll be honest with you, are you ladies worth that money? Yes, but can you really believe that tickets used to be like $25, you get a good seat,
mm-hmm.
and now you get an even decent seat. Most people have to work at least a third of the week just to be able to afford a ticket to go to any show. Do you think that's a little outrageous sometimes for what they're doing? Because you know the producers are the ones that make the most money.
Right. I think the biggest mistake that promoters make really is not understanding who their core audience and their demographic is. They get their demographic and their analytics of who's actually coming into their clubs. They get that confused with who their favorites are. So you'll have a promoter that will, you know, that will book talent because that's it's just been their dream to see this person perform, but they got a club full of 21-year-olds, and it's like you have to make it make sense. You can take losses like that, or vice versa. You'll have the promoter who thinks they need to get the young hot somebody, so they spend $100,000 to bring in, you know, to bring in the baby or, you know, the newer, younger right now acts, but you've got a club full of 40-year-olds who don't want to hear that shit. So it's like, it's really about the promoter just understanding who his or her crowd is and booking the acts accordingly, whether or not you're a personal fan of that artist, you know, right. If you're in the business of making money as a promoter or a booking agent, like, those are the factors that you have to consider, not, you know, do I feel like listening to this person's music all night?
Exactly, and I 100% agree with you. That's why I asked you that question, because people need to understand, if you're going to be a promoter, you have to be smart about it. And you're talking to a smart woman here, because I know for a fact, you were actually, I believe, offered a scholarship to MIT.
And
at that point, you pretty much realized, you know what? I want to pursue my passion. I know I can go to the school, but my passion is not engineering. That was something I did because I'm good at math and science, right? Your passion, you knew right away, was music. And was that a hard decision for you to really give up a scholarship to one of the most prestigious schools in the country to pursue music? How hard was that for you to really decide to do that?
It wasn't hard at all. I think my family took it harder than I did, because I knew what I wanted. I was clear. I think, there are times now where I will daydream and wonder to myself, what would engineer Rah Digga be doing right now today? Or I wouldn't even be Rah Digga. It's like, what would engineering Rachia Fisher be doing right now if mm-hmm. I hadn't, you know, traveled down the beaten path of becoming Rah Digga? And I don't know. I don't know. It's a daydream of mine. I always say to myself, before this lifetime is over, I am going to do something techie. I am going to fulfill my engineering brain somehow, some way. But, it's been a beautiful life, man. I can't complain. I don't have any regrets. If I could have one do-over, I probably wouldn't have left Elektra Records. I say that would probably be my one do-over.
Yeah, and I love hearing that you don't regret. You want to know something, too? Always look at some of the bad decisions that we possibly made in the past. Puts us on the right path to where we need to be.
That's right.
That's the way I look at life, is if you can make bad decisions, and that has to do with relationships, business, If you ate a bad, like, you know, fish, piece of fish, maybe you were meant to go to the hospital, meet the doctor who you're going to end up marrying, you know? And
yep.
That's how fate is fate. But yeah. I do like
what I you believe said in you that. Love life. I do believe in karmatic energy like that. I do believe that there's no such thing as coincidence. Like, you are where you're supposed to be at whatever time you're supposed to be there. And you know, sometimes hard lessons are learned, but they are learned for a reason. They're supposed to, you know, you're supposed to go through some sort of struggle and strife. It builds character, you know, whatever doesn't kill you, make you stronger. And all of those life lessons definitely prepared me to be the woman that I am today. It's like, now I have a whole nother mind frame now when I talk to people, as far as like work, business, everything. Like, no, I don't just want a front half and I don't just want an advance and a back end. Like, no, you're not talking to the happy to be here, you know, rapper girl anymore that just loves music. Like, no, I want some stocks. Now I want, you know, it's just a different world. And when you communicate like that to people, like, oftentimes they're surprised, because there is a very low opinion of rappers, especially now, especially with what is being pushed to the mainstream and the forefront. They put the genre in a hole, in a box, and a lot of people are surprised when they speak to someone who's in the, you know, who's a rapper or who's in the music business, and you realize that, hey, this person's a lot smarter than I thought. Like, no, I'm not gonna be able to dangle a carrot or a check in front of this one. Like, no, you can actually keep your check. Pay me in stocks. Pay me in Bitcoin. You know, yeah. I'm different now. It's you know.
You're seasoned, where you learn.
That's
like
right.
Like wine. Like, the older you got, you age better, right? You learn, yep. You taste better, and you're starting to learn life where now you can give back.
Yeah.
As getting to the end, first of all, I'm a techie guy myself. I say this to a lot of people on interviews. My brother Scott's one of the CEOs of Logitech. So I'm a big techie guy, and so I want to congratulate you on your website. And the reason why I'm saying that, your website is very clean, it's easy to read, and it's so much info on there that if you really want to know everything about you, it's
everything
so
is right there.
It's awesome. And when I hit you up, and the reason why I hit you up personally, because I always know that no matter how great somebody's site is, there's always something about somebody that is not written on their website. That's always good to talk about.
I try to keep it updated as much as possible. Every little thing I do, I try to throw it on there. By the way, I made that website myself. I don't have any, I don't have site designers or anything like that. I do all of that myself.
And it's better, and that's awesome. Congrats, because I had to learn to do myself too. And it's better you do, because I'm going to give people a hint. Not to diss on website designers, but learn how to do a website. It's really not that hard, Squarespace, whatever, because
yep.
You own the content. You don't have to wait for anybody to upload crap. You don't be like, oh, I'll do it next week. Everybody knows everything's quick today. So if Rah Digga takes a picture with Bruce Springsteen, you know damn well she's getting home and she's going to upload that thing in like 5 minutes, because that's, you know what I'm saying? That's a picture to show.
Yeah,
you know, two legends right there doing their thing. As we get also to the end of repeat, Flipmo Squad,
mm-hmm.
Are you guys going to do something together as we're going into the late 2021-22? Is there anything in the works that you can talk about?
Absolutely. Would you believe we have a whole second album complete in the can, ready to go? Like, it literally can be uploaded tomorrow if Busta so chooses to do so. It's been completed since 2018. It was to commemorate the 20th anniversary of Flip Mode's first album, Imperial, which was released in September of 98. So the original goal was to release this album in September of 2018. But then what happened is we were, you know, first we were going to just throw it out to the internet, but I think it came out a lot better than anybody expected. So then we just added more names to it. The project got bigger. We reunited all of the original members, Lord have mercy included. And then right. and then we ended up not putting it out because to my understanding, Busta was looking for a major situation for it. And then at the same time he was simultaneously working on his album that just released, the ELE2. So that was there was a lot going on with him, and I think really it's just whichever way the wind blows, like, oh, I gotta get this solo album out. So that'll be today's thinking, and then tomorrow's thinking was like, oh wait, we gotta get this Flip Mode album out. So it's just know it's in the can, ready to go at any moment. Trust me, when it drops, I will be just as excited as the rest of our fans. Like, oh, we got an album out. Yay!
That is awesome. I have a feeling that if he does pop it, I think the first thing you guys probably get to do is collaborate and put a dope-ass video together.
Word.
And people don't understand. Music is one thing. There ain't nothing like doing a music video, because I know you're an actress, so that's where your acting thing comes out.
See, I live for the shows. I live for the shows. Like, I can lock myself in a studio all day. For me, the real test of your artistry is, can you perform it? Can you bring the song to life? You got so many artists now who are, they're not really outside kids. They're like inside kids. And they hey, Godfrey, I see Godfrey in the building, one of my co-hosts from the, you know what I mean, Godcast that I do with Lord Jamar and comedian Godfrey.
That's not Gilbert Godfrey, is it?
Comedian
Godfrey. I gotta ask, because there's a Gilbert Godfrey and comedian Godfrey. I'm like, wait, which one is
now? That's our African prince Godfrey.
That's what I like to hear. All right. I gotta ask, because we want to make sure people are gonna follow the right part. You know what I'm saying?
No, absolutely. Shouts out to Godfrey. Nah, he moving and shaking out here. My man got movies going on, stand-ups with Tiffany Haddish.
Yeah, and Tiffany, by the way, you know what's funny? I wouldn't be surprised if your producers reach out to her. Funny or not, that's just the way some of these guys are, because Tiffany's dropping a new music video soon. And I know all about it. Because the director, Tiffany Haddish, the
director. Dropping a new video? Say word.
Yeah. I'm giving everybody an exclusive right now. Tiffany Haddish is dropping a music video. Okay. I know it really well, because the director of the music video is Casey Amos, which is the son of John Amos from Good Times. That's family to me, those two.
Okay.
And it's going to feature Trina. It's got Jada Pinkett Smith. John Amos is in it as well.
Oh, wow.
And this guy, Begets, who's also the older brother of AZ from The Firm.
Okay.
So it's called Come and Get Your Baby's Daddy.
Oh, wow. Shout out to Tiffany. I love her.
I want to let you know that she is such a sweetheart. She don't want
to work these bars, but shout out to Tiffany. I applaud anybody trying to, spread their wings, expand their horizons. Nothing wrong with multifaceting.
I know. Everybody's trying to get in everything. People heard me do a lot of hip-hop and rap, and they're like, yo, Todd, you should drop an album. And I go, no, listen, let me keep it real. I'm not a hip-hop artist. I'm not a rapper. I'm an entertainer. There's a huge difference. Because if you stick me on the corner with, like, a Mos Def, I'm most likely going to be deaf, because he's going to speak over me so much. I'm going to sit there and look for my boxers, because I have no idea why I'm on that corner. I'm an entertainer. And I'm saying that because people need to realize that there's a real hip-hop artist that's like a Rah Digga. And then there's a Todd Wharton, who's just an entertainer to make people smile. There's a huge difference.
There you go.
Because if I battle you, it's not a battle.
It's not.
At all. It's not at all. I'm going to look at you and be like, yo, Digga, could you kind of like take it easy on me? Could you like,
yeah, you don't know. You don't want these problems. Well, hey, in all fairness to you, none of the real rappers want these problems either. So you don't be too hard on yourself. They all
incredible MC. And you want to know something? Not only you have a good voice for being an MC, you have such a dope flow about you. Right? You could flow. I can hear your words. And I'm just like, I can listen to Rah Digga all day. Like, this is great.
I mean, you know, that comes from making music at a time where we had to use reel-to-reels and we weren't able to cut and paste our music. We had to literally go in the studio and press record and rap from the start of the song to the end of the song. And if you fuck up, you got to start from the beginning, and nobody wants to do that shit all night. So you're gonna get it right immediately. Take one. You know, I'm notorious for, you know, I'm known for being a one and done, like one take ride, two for safety. So if you was there, if you know them terms, two for safety, and you know, that's always been my you know, that's always been my C and when it comes to recording in the studio and stuff. But you know, I still, it's like muscle memory at this point. Once you, I feel like, you know, I know they say if you don't use it, you lose it, but I feel like real artists get better with age. They get better with time. They age like, you know, it's like fine wine. Like, it should never leave here. So when I see, you know, when I host a Sharrock day and I see 60, 70-year-olds grabbing the microphone, doing it better than the 20, 30-year-olds, like, that just goes to show you, you know, this, it's an art. It's something that, you know, it should be enhanced as time goes on. If I feel like the ones that fall off, I'm not going to say they weren't artists to begin with, but you just really had to go through something. Like, even if you went through the worst of life circumstances, like, your mind is still your mind, you know what I mean? So I feel like if you lose it somewhere along the way, you were not devoted enough to your artistry.
Yeah, and I 100% agree with you.
You know, you can get rusty, you can get writer's block. I mean, there are acceptable, you know, shortstops, if you will, but to just straight up be trash now and you were like the bomb back then, yeah, it kind of, you know, got to kind of wonder about some of them folk.
And I 100% agree with you. And first of all, Rah Digga, thank you for being on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Really appreciate you.
No doubt.
I love the interview. I love learning a lot of great things from you. I love that Flip Mode's coming out. Thank you for what you do for the community. We need a lot more people like you to come out and show out, right? Come out and show out. That's a big deal with me. And if you guys don't know, go to rahdigga.com. You can find out everything you need to know about her.
RahDiggaMusic.com.
Yeah. Right, go to RahDiggaMusic.com. I always give the website out because instead of saying all your handles, guys, if you really want to know, get to know somebody.
It's all there. I don't even go through the motions of my handles. Everything is right there. All of my IG, Twitter, Facebook, all of that's on there. And all of my money handles are there too. So if the spirit moves you to donate to the cause and support your favorite independent underrated, there I was on RahDiggaMusic.com.
That's right, man. So when you have a itchy trigger finger, donate a dollar to my girl Rah Digga. Okay?
That's right. That's right.
So guys, I hope you guys enjoyed the interview with Rah Digga. Rah, thank you so much for being on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. I appreciate you. I'm sure I'm going to be seeing you a lot in a lot of events coming up.
Thank you for having me. We're making good time, too. I see the sun is slowly moving. Look, you see it's starting to eclipse me. I'm like, right here. I see too much of my face cut off.
I see that. The sun's going down, and so is this interview, and it was a good one. This full interview will be up probably either over the weekend or Monday. I'll have a full episode up on FaceTime with Todd Wharton, and everybody can watch the recap of this that couldn't be on tonight. Everybody be safe. Rah, I'll talk to you soon, and enjoy Dallas while you're out there, and I appreciate you.
Absolutely. And if anybody's in the Dallas area, in the Texas area, make sure y'all come down to the Deep Ellum area Saturday, July 10th. I am celebrating, well, what should have been the 20th anniversary, April of last year. It is now the 21st anniversary of my debut album, Dirty Harriet. I'm performing with a great band called the Beatitudes, and I'm just performing the entire Dirty Harriet album from start to finish. Nothing else but Dirty Harriet. You're not getting Touch It. You're not getting Party and Boy. You're not getting any of the other beautiful records that I'm on. You are getting the Dirty Harriet album from start to finish. Live band. It's going to also be live streamed, and it's also going to be a live album. So come on down, have some fun, get loud so you can hear yourself on the album when it releases. But thank you so much for having me, Mr. Wharton. I appreciate you.
I appreciate you too, and good luck on the show in Dallas, man. I wish I was down there to hear it, but I'm sure you'll perform up here as well.
Oh,
so we look forward to that in the NYC.
Definitely taking the show on the road. Dirty Harry was that shit.
And I love it. I love it. I can't wait to get some Dirty Harry. Okay. All right. I'll see you soon. Guys, have a great night. Rah Digga, be safe. Okay.
Love. Peace, everybody.
Wow, such an inspirational woman, like I say about a lot of my guests, but Rah Digga is definitely the truth. Thank you for giving back to the community. That's such a selfless act. And Rah, you are such an amazing MC, and then I love the fact that you're representing the best of what female MCs are all about. So guys, I hope you enjoyed that interview, and thank you to my live virtual audience for always keeping on and staying on with me on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Tune in tomorrow night as I have a great guest, Kendra Checkets, who is the season 16 finalist on The Voice, pop R&B singer, and we're going to chop it up tomorrow night. Guys, be safe, be well, and like I always say, you're not living a passionate life, and who's like you live. Guys, have a great night. Take care. Hey guys, thanks for watching. And while you're here, you might as well subscribe to my YouTube channel. And for more information on the show, go to FaceTimeWithToddWharton.com. Ma, I'm shooting a promo. Why you always gotta ruin my flavor?